Okay, so how is everyone today? Good? Okay, so last time we were talking about lines. We're still talking about lines a little bit. So, just to review from last time we went over what if we had a point and a slope. So if it so happens that we're talking about a line, and the line is known to go through this point and known to have this slope, M. If that is the case, then what is the equation of the line? So it would be, so the equation is y minus y1, and then what?
Over x. Wait. Oh, the
Is
equation.
The equation.
Getting confused.
M parentheses x parentheses.
Yes. Okay. So visually, this is saying that, well, if you found yourself with a line that was sloping and you wanted to know its equation, then you could determine its equation in the following way. You could say, well, I'm going to take any old point that's on the line, for example, that one, and measure its coordinates with the ruler. Okay, so it happens to have some point. And then from that point, we can measure its slope by measuring individually a run and a rise. And then computing the ratio, rise over run. And that would tell us. Okay, so then this equation is called the point slope equation because that's either the data that you know, or given a line, that's the data that you measure. And then you can come up with the equation for the line. So, 2. The other form of the line that we went over, named form, is called slope intercept. So here, what you have is you're given the slope, it's m, and you're given a y-intercept. So really, a slightly better name for this equation might be slope y-intercept form to avoid any potential confusion. So an intercept in particular is a point on the line, but it happens to be the place where the line crosses over the y-axis. So that it's notable in that way. And for that reason, you know automatically one of the coordinates. Which coordinate do you know, and what is its value? Without even measuring, you know. You know that x has to be 0. By virtue of the phrase that this is where it crosses the y-axis, you know that x has to be 0. And then you can actually get out your ruler and measure and say, okay, well, maybe I measured it to be b. So if you have a line that has slope m and y-coordinate of y-intercept equal to b, then the formula is what? What is it? Yes, y is mx plus b. And visually,
And alternatively, that would be like saying, okay, here we have a line. And instead of measuring any old point, right, for this one we said, well, I like that point right there. That's the one I'm going to measure. So which specific point are we going to measure for this one? Right. This one right here. So we're interested in that one now. So we measure that. And then we measure a run and a rise. Compute the ratio to find the slope. And there we have it. So any question about this? So these equations are named after the data that you have. Point slope and slope intercept. And then finally we said, well, all lines can be expressed as AX plus BY equal to C for constants A, B, and C, and A and B are not both zero. Which is to say, it's fine for one of them to be zero, but if one of them is zero, the other necessarily is not. So, in our considerations, we said, well, if it so happens that A is zero in this equation, that means that we don't have that term that I'm covering up. And we have BY as C. And if A is zero, that means B isn't, so we can solve for Y. So Y is a constant. What kind of line is Y equal to a constant?
Horizontal
line. It would be like if it were the case that everyone in this room was 5'6". And then we all stood shoulder to shoulder, being 5'6", then you could measure the tops of our heads, and they'd all be at 5'6", and it would be a horizontal line. Because in this class, we have a constant height. Okay. Alternatively, if B is zero, that means we don't have that term, and AX is the one that we do have. If B is zero, then A necessarily is not. We could divide by A to solve for X, so X is equal to a constant. What kind of line is X equal to a constant? A vertical line. And then finally, if neither is zero, that means that we could solve for Y. And when you do so, there would be a non-zero coefficient on X. And such a line would be a sloped line. So this represents every conceivable line. Okay, that's what we did last time. Any question about that? Okay, so there's some further matters about lines that we need to establish. So this remark is about parallel. So P-A-R-A. So, pretty much everyone knows already, I think, intuitively what parallel means, having been taught that as a child. So, a notable example of parallelness is railroad tracks, at least in the part of the railroad track that's straight. Right? So, the rails run side by side, never getting closer or further away from each other and never touching each other. So there's two possibilities for parallel. So here's one possibility. So the red line, I'll say, is M1X plus B1. And then here's green line,
y is m2, x plus b2.
Okay, so those two lines are parallel in the sense that they run side by side and they never touch each other. Okay.
So now, that's the geometric condition, that is to say visually how it occurs. What is the algebraic condition which must be true for these lines?
Right. So it must be the case that they have the same slope. And therefore, algebraically, it must be the case that M1 is equal to M2.
Okay, I have a question for you. What if I take the green line and I move it up until it's on top of the red line? Are the red and the green line then parallel? So, it's yes, they're the same line. So, is a line parallel to itself?
Yeah.
Yes. Because suppose that a line had slope 3. Then, does the line have slope 3?
Yes.
Okay, and is 3 equal to 3? Ah, it is. So, lines are parallel to themselves. Okay. Now, believe it or not, this is not the only possibility for parallelness. There's another possibility where lines might not have the same slope and yet still be parallel. So what am I talking about?
So this is sort of a mathematician's issue. You'll give me an eye roll probably when I show you. Sorry? Yes, so what does that mean?
They're horizontal and vertical.
Vertical.
Vertical, not horizontal.
Right, so here's a line. It's vertical. X is A. Here's another one that's vertical.
Those two lines are both vertical, and they're parallel.
So this is the other possibility.
And why is it that this case is not a special case of that one? Why don't these have the same slope? Neither one of them has any slope. So they couldn't possibly be the same. Okay. Good. Any question about this?
So here's one exercise about this. So this exercise is kind of trivial. Like I have small children, and I believe I could ask either one of them to answer this question, and they would have no problem. And so I suspect you have no problem either. So here's a line. Here's a point.
So I gave you red line and green point. I want you to draw a line passing through the green point, which is parallel to the red line. And it's not a trick question.
So is it clear what I'm requesting? So, at any rate, the way I solve such an exercise is I turn the line that I want to draw parallel to be pointing at me, because it's easiest for human beings to draw a line, straight lines anyway, in this direction.
That's what I was asking for. Any question about that exercise? Now, that exercise is kind of trivial for a human, but you have to understand that that's only because human beings have incredibly advanced visual systems installed. Okay, here's the same question.
but as a calculation. Find the equation of the line. Parallel to 2x minus 3y is equal to 7, and passing through the point 1, 5. So it's the same exercise. In the end. So what do you think? Good, right? So then we know two ways to find the equation of a line. We know the slope intercept, and we know point slope. So that's the data that you have. And notably that for both of them, they both have the word slope in them, right? Point slope and slope intercept. So in order to answer this question, is it clear that we surely must have a slope somehow? Okay. So then furthermore, because we're looking for a parallel line, that means that whatever line we're looking for has to have the same slope as that line. So what we really need is the slope of that line. So how do we do it? And you said it. So how is it? Okay, very good. So if we take this one, this line, and we put it in slope-intercept form, which is to say, solve for y. So negative 3y is negative 2x plus 7, and then divide by negative 3, so y is negative 2 over negative 3x plus 7 over negative 3, and then this stands just a little simplification, so y is 2/3 x minus 7/3. So is that the line that we were looking for? No. But it does tell us something important. What? The slope of the line we're looking for. That's just, when you write with a fountain pen, every once in a while, it wells up and then it gets flicked down on the page like that. Okay, so then that tells us that m is 2/3. This value. Now what? Point slope form. Therefore, y minus y1 is m x minus x1. So y minus 5 is 2/3 x minus 1. So y minus 5 is 2/3 x minus 2/3. Then we want to add 5 to both sides. Well, 5 is 15/3, right? And then we want to add 15/3 to both sides. So that would be 13/3 on the right. Okay, any question about that? So now qualitatively, here's the two lines that are in play. Those two. Indicated there. Do they have the same slope? Yes. Is that a good thing? Yeah. Yes. because we were asking for parallel lines. Notably, what's different? The intercept, right? So the line that we found, is it the same line as the line that we started with?
No.
It's not the same line. So it must be higher or lower. So the line that we found, was it higher or lower than the one we were given? It's higher, because its intercept is higher. Any question about this? Okay, one more. Find the equation of the line parallel to x equal to 8 through the point negative 4, 9. For some of you, the answer is obvious. For some of you, this question is so easy it's difficult. If you take my meaning. So what do you think? X is negative 4. Requires essentially no work. Now, why should it be so easy? Right. So, what's happening here, this question is equivalent to the following. I could say, okay, here's the axis. That's the axis. And then x equal to 8 is like over here. And then I'm saying, I want you to draw a line parallel to that one going through this point. Well, okay, I think that's obvious enough. It would be that one. And what is the equation of that line? Yeah. Any question about this? Okay. No discussion about, or let's say it like this, every discussion of parallel has to be immediately followed with what? Perpendicular. Okay, so now visually, so what does perpendicular mean is in the visual sense?
Crossing at a right angle.
Crossing at a right angle. Very good. So if this is y is m1, x plus b1, and this y is m2, x plus b2. So we've got two lines, and they're crossing at a right angle. So this is by analogy to the previous page, okay, where we said, okay, if we have two lines like so, then what's the algebraic condition on their slopes? Their slopes must be the same. Now the question is, well, suppose we have two lines like this. what must be the algebraic condition on their slopes? It has something to do with reciprocal. It's negative reciprocal. Okay, so there's two main operations that we deal with in this class, arithmetic operations, that is to say, multiply and add. The formula for additive inverse is negation. The formula for multiplicative inverse is reciprocal. And to do perpendicular slopes, it's both of these, negative reciprocal. Slopes must be negative reciprocals. Now, it's an interesting exercise to show why this is the case, but I'm going to omit it for now. The way a mathematician would write this algebraically is like this. The product of the slopes has to be negative 1. And then if you learn this in Mrs. Harris's class in 7th grade or whatever, then probably the way it would be written is like this. M2 is negative 1 over M1. So to be clear about this, I could ask and say, well, what is the perpendicular slope to slope 3? Negative 1/3. Okay, what is the perpendicular slope to slope 4/5? Negative 5/4. Okay. What is the perpendicular slope to negative 2/7? 7/2. So to get from one to the other, and notice that I drew the arrow one way, but it goes both ways, which is to say, what is the perpendicular slope of 7/2? Negative 2/7. So, yes?
What if the slope for there is a square root?
So like this? What if it had slope square root 2?
Yeah. Or, and then you
have it would just be 1/√2. Or negative 1/√2. You might be asking, do I want you to simplify it and do other stuff like that? And the answer is, I'm never going to give you a line with with slope square root 2. I'm just going to avoid the issue. Okay. Now, this is not every possible case. What other case is there? Mm-hmm. When one of them doesn't have a slope.
So the other possibility is when one of them is vertical.
So that case has to be singled out because, one of them doesn't have a slope, so it couldn't possibly be the case that their slopes are negative reciprocals of each other. Okay, so again, for the sort of elementary school version of this exercise, the visual version, I could say, well, here's a line nice line there. And then here's a point. Please draw for me the line which passes through the indicated point perpendicular to the other line. And yes, this question is as easy as it seems. Okay, so at least when I'm doing this kind of exercise, the way I do it is I take the one line and I hold it horizontal to me so that the line that I'm going to draw is going directly at me. And then I do this. Any question about that exercise? So the one that has just slight interest, possibly, is if I say, okay, find the equation of the line perpendicular to 3x minus 4y is equal to 5 and through the point, say, 2, 6. And I'd like to point out, while you're thinking about it, that this calculation exercise is exactly the same as the visual exercise. I gave you the exact same information anyway. I gave you a point and a line. So how should we proceed? So we'll take this thing, negative 4y is negative 3x plus 5, and then divide by negative 4 to obtain that y is 3/4 x minus 5/4. So is that's the line we were looking for? No. No. So, what does it tell us that we are looking for?
Slope -4.
Right. So the perpendicular slope to that line is m is negative 4 over 3. So we want the perpendicular slope to this one. So any question about obtaining the slope? Now what? Same thing we do every time now, right? Every time we have a point and a slope, okay, we'll use the point-slope form. So, y minus y1 is m, x minus x1. So y minus 6 is negative 4/3 times x minus 2. So y minus 6 is negative 4/3 x plus 8/3. And then we want to add 6, but 6 is 18/3.
So 18/3 plus 8/3 is 26/3. Any question about that exercise? This one is okay. Okay. One last quickie, because it's such a low-hanging fruit, is that now I want you to find an equation. Equation of the line which is perpendicular to x is equal to 5 and through the point 2, -9. What is it? Why is -9? No work. Why should it be so easy?
It's like what we did before, but now you have the y.
Mm-hmm. Right, so we want a line that's perpendicular to the line x is 5. Well, x is 5 happens to be what?
Vertical.
So what we're looking for is a horizontal line, which means that it should have the form y equal to some constant. It should take that form. And furthermore, it goes through that point, which happens to have y-coordinate -9, which means that all of the points have y-coordinate -9. Okay, and then one more. Here's a fun kind of thing we can do here. I can say here's two points, point A and point B. I want you to draw now, so plot the line through the midpoint of A and B, which is perpendicular to the line through A and B. Okay, so how do we do this?
Well, you need the slope of the line through A and B, and then the point, the midpoint would be the point you're drawing it through. So it's like the same as before. Mm-hmm. You just need to find the midpoint.
Right. So, and it's a drawing question, not a calculation question.
Oh.
So, I think probably good to start by drawing the line segment. And then, the line that we're looking for goes through the midpoint. So probably good to draw that. Out there-ish. So that's the midpoint. And then what else did we request of it? Yeah, so it needs to be perpendicular to that segment. So is there any question why it's the green line that we were looking for? Slightly more entertaining, or at least just different anyway, is if I give you exactly the same exercise, but give you coordinates and not a picture now. So now you have to do a calculation. But it's exactly the same. I give you two points, you calculate the midpoint.
you calculate the slope. Any question about this? Okay. So now a slightly different matter. And this is, so just to forewarn you, this matter is, I get a lot of blowback from college algebra students on this because, two reasons. In the first place, it is slightly different than what you may have already learned in Mrs. Harris's class. Okay, so it's a slight difference, so that causes a bit of a ruffles feathers. And this difference amounts to you having to do more work, which ruffles a lot of feathers. Okay? But it is what it is, okay? So I could say, okay, I want you to solve the equation three over x minus six is equal to five over x. So now, back in the day when you were doing this, in secondary school or wherever you did that, maybe, you would just proceed to immediately start calculating things. Okay? That's not permissible here. The very first thing that you must do is you must clearly state what the natural domain is. Now, would someone please remind us, what does that mean, natural domain? Exist, right? So, which is to say, what x is it conceived that could you conceivably plug in here? Or alternatively, to ask the question backwards, are there any questions that you just couldn't, are there any x's you just could not plug in? Six would not be permissible. Why is it not permissible to plug in six?
You make a zero on the top.
Right. So, for the left hand side, if we were to plug in 6, that would cause a division by 0. This is not okay. It's fine on the right-hand side. You can plug in 6. But the fact that you can't plug it in here means that it's just not acceptable altogether. Are there any other x's that are not permissible? 0. Okay. So the natural domain is all x except x equal to 6 and x equal to 0. So now, on these exercises, I'll be clear and tell you how I want such sets to be represented. But for now, let's just represent it in all the ways that we know. So if we were to draw this as a plot, draw this set as a plot, how would it look?
A line with circles on 6 and 0.
Yes.
Zero.
So it would be a number line with 0 and 6 deleted. And if we wanted to express this in interval notation, how do we express it in interval notation?
-6.
Okay, not quite.
I mean to 0.
Okay, good. To 0. And then union. 0 to 6. And then union 6 to infinity. So now, can you write that interval notation in a simpler way, which is to say, like on those other exercises where we did unions and we could express it as, we could simplify the union away. Can you do that here? Why not? Visually, what does it mean to be able to simplify away a union?
The overlap.
It means that there's overlap, right? This is a contiguous piece that shares nothing with that contiguous piece,
that shares nothing with that contiguous piece. You cannot simplify the unions away because there's no sharing, no overlap. Okay? Now, let's make a matter pretty clear here. So here's a particular point. 7. Right? 7 is in that piece, or in that interval, whatever you like. Now, what if we plug in 7 to the equation? What would the left-hand side become? If we plug in x as 7. The left-hand side would be 3, right? Because it would be 3 in the numerator and 7 minus 6 in the denominator. Well, that's 1, and 3 over 1 is 3. So the left-hand side would be 3. And the right-hand side would be 5 over 7. So is 3, in fact, equal to 5 over 7? It isn't. So now I have a question for you. Is 7 in the natural domain? Yes, it is in the natural domain. Yeah, 7 is in the natural domain. It is. What does it mean to be in the natural domain? Right. It's something that you could plug into the equation. And that doesn't mean that the equation, in consequence, will evaluate to logical truth or false. It just means that it can be evaluated at all. Can you evaluate this at 7? Sure you can. What does it evaluate to? False. So that means that 7 is part of the natural domain, but it's not part of the solution. Okay? Do you understand the distinction? I'm harping on this point because students get these two mixed up. The natural domain is the set of all values which could be plugged in without regard to the logical value of the equation. The solution is the subset of the natural domain that when you evaluate the equation, you get logical truth. Now, notably, is 15 in the natural domain? It is. And what if we plug in 15? Well, we'd get 3 over 15 minus 6, which is 9. 3 over 9 is a third. And then 5 over 15 is a third. Well, is 15 in the natural domain? Yes. Is 15 in the solution? Yes. Okay, now let's verify that that is true, that that's the case. So now that we've done this, now we proceed with algebra. So 3 over x minus 6 is equal to 5 over x. And now I'm perfectly aware that many of you know what to do, but I'm still going to do this in slow-mo since this is the first time I'm doing it for y'all. So the way to proceed is, okay, what we need to overcome is the fact that there are variables in the denominator. That's the most outstanding problem that we have currently. So to overcome that, I'm going to multiply both sides by x. Now, why do you suppose I would want to do that? What would that accomplish? On the right-hand side. So then we would get, on the left-hand side, 3x over x minus 6, which is maybe even worse, but the right-hand side would be 5. So does everyone see the action that occurred? Now, let's be perfectly clear here. On the right-hand side, we canceled the x's. Is it permissible to cancel such x's? And the answer is, it depends. It depends. So, is it okay to cancel, say, 13 over 13? Yeah? How about 13 million over 13 million? Yeah? How about negative 7 over negative 7? Yeah? So, is it always permissible to cancel x over x? It is not. When is it not permissible?
There's just exactly one case when it would not be okay. No takers? Yeah. When x is 0, then it would not be permissible. You cannot cancel 0 over 0.
How do we know that that didn't just happen? How do we know that we're safe and protected from that? Because we already established the natural domain of this exercise. That's what this is saying. This is saying that our universe consists of all the points except 0 and 6. So when we did this, we didn't break the universe. Okay? It's permissible. So now, to finish it up very quickly now, what would be the next thing? So by analogy to this step, the next thing to do would be to multiply by x minus 6 over x minus on both sides to cancel the left-hand side so that we get 3x is 5x minus 6 and then 5x minus 30 so that 30 is 2x. Sorry, I'm rushing now. 15 is x. And then the last thing you have to check is this part of the natural domain? So is it?
Yes.
It is. So then the answer is x equal to 15. And we'll do a lot more of these next time. So have a nice Monday.